Now let's continue talking about visualization analysis and design with task abstractions. So that four-level nested model emphasized the idea that there's domain, abstraction, idiom, and algorithm. And let's talk about this transition from domain to abstraction. So domain characterization is where we really care about taking the details of some particular application domain. And that's things like that there's some group of users that we presume to be in a particular target domain. So what are their questions? What is their data like? And the point was that that varies wildly by domain. And we need to do something that's domain specific in many cases to really get traction on solving the visualization problem. This is where we don't want to build a completely general toolkit to be applied to anything, but we want to apply to a particular domain situation. So what we need to do is we need to take these domain specific questions and problems and we need to break them down into simpler abstract tasks. And that's what this segment is all about. So we want to go from the domain specific level to the abstraction level. We've already talked about data, now we're going to talk about tasks. We want to map both the what and the why into generalized terms. So what we need to do is then understand the kinds of tasks that users would want to do or maybe that they already do. And we need to understand what data types would support those tasks. And it could be that we need to transform or derive new data if we don't already have that in the appropriate format. And that transformation is guided by the task abstraction. So if we think about the design process, if we're doing problem-driven design, where we start out with a domain situation and we in parallel are thinking about mapping the domain language data to some sort of data abstraction and mapping the domain language task to some abstract task. And that's what I'm focusing on here. And then the combination of the abstract data and task is what we need to do idiom creation and then to do algorithm identification or creation. So with task abstractions, it's useful to think about this idea of having an action target pair. It's a very, very high level pattern for thinking. If you start reading about visualization, you'll very often see things like discover a distribution or compare trends or locate outliers or browse topology. And it's all these action verbs and target noun pairs. So let's think about what a set of these could be that would be interesting to us. So I'm going to propose a set of actions, analyzing, these are some very high level choices, searching to find particular items, querying to find out about item characteristics. And these actions take place in the context of a target, what exactly is being acted on. And there's a certain amount of dependencies and independencies between these. So let's talk through it. So for actions, for analyzing, I'm going to distinguish between consuming and producing. So when you're consuming a given data set, there is this classic split between discovery and presentation or exploring and explaining. And there's also an interesting one, which is enjoying, which is not quite as classic. Sometimes people call that casual visualization or social visualization, where it's not exactly necessarily something that is your day job to analyze, but you still end up engaging with that data in some way. And the point here is that this consuming is a little bit different than producing. There's situations in visualization context where you produce data as part of that visualization session. Maybe you're annotating by adding information. Maybe you're recording an entire analysis session and maybe logging things down to every mouse click. And one of the values of that is that you could then have the history of any kind of analysis process in case you want to replicate it or show somebody else in the future through a presentation. And then, as I talked about with data, there's this idea of deriving new data as a really critical design choice. So that is one of the major ways we're going to handle complexity is by deriving new data. And we think of that as data that's being produced as part of the visualizing process. Now for search, there's an interesting thing to think about, which is, well, what does the user know? And we can think about that in terms of both the target of the search and the location. So let's walk through these four cases. So lookup, where we know the target and we know the location, a great example of that is you look up a word in a dictionary. And the reason you can find the word quickly is because you know they're in alphabetical order. So if you can spell the word, you can fairly quickly actually get to that word. But What if you can't find your keys? You know they're in your house somewhere, but you're not quite sure where. So that's when you know the target you want, which is your keys, but you don't know its location. It could be anywhere. Or in a more visualization-oriented approach, what if you're looking for a node in a network and say you've laid that network out as a collection of nodes and links? They're not in alphabetical order. So how do you just find the name you're looking for? You might have to actually be hunting around. So locating is something that is often more tricky than simply looking up. Another example is browsing. So in browsing, you know where to look, but you don't know what you're looking for. And a classic example is you're in a bookstore and they've got sections, right? They have gardening versus cooking versus science fiction. So you have some sense of the kind of thing that will be there. But maybe you don't know which book you want to buy and you're browsing to get a sense of what is in a particular location and then what appeals. And then finally, exploring is the word I'm using for this sort of, you don't know what you're looking for and you don't know where it is, but maybe you have some criteria for trying to figure out what it is, but you know neither one of those two things. And an example in a real world setting is, what if you're trying to find a cool neighborhood in some new city that you don't know well? Well, you know, cool is going to sort of depend. You don't know where to find it. You have some sense of what you're looking for, but you're not doing a targeted sort of a thing the way you do with lookup or locate. So that's one way to shed some light on some of the various considerations on searching. People don't necessarily in the visualization literature use all these words in the exact way I've proposed here. People use explore in quite a lot of different ways to mean a lot of different things. But this gives you some way to think about this question of, is the target and the location known or unknown? Another consideration is query. So how much of the data matters for solving the specific problem that you're trying to address? And it's useful to split this up into one and some and all. So if what you're trying to do is identify one thing, well, let's call that identify. You're trying to identify one thing. Maybe you don't know where it is, but you're trying to find that one thing. In contrast, some questions require comparing a small number of things to each other. Pairwise comparison, very common, or comparing a relatively small number of things. So then you're not just trying to find one thing, you're trying to compare a few things to each other. And then finally, there's some questions that require looking at all the data. You need to summarize it, have some sort of an overview where you understand the characteristics of all of it. So these are different kinds of abstractions of when you're looking for something, what sort of a thing are you looking for? One, a few, or do you need to see them all? A key point I want to make is that these three levels of analyze and search and query, these are completely independent of each other. And so you can really do this sort of mix and match. And so that sort of sheds light on the fact that even though, you know, discovery and presentation might be really different ultimate goals, a lot of the low level visual encoding approaches are relevant for both of those. It's possible to make some distinctions about discovery versus presentation, but the independence of these choices is part of why there is this huge design space of possibilities on how we would visually encode. And there are many ways of thinking about tasks that are not specific to discovery versus presentation. So we've talked about actions, those are verbs. What about these target nouns? So some kinds of actions are applicable to any sort of target. Pretty much any data set you would see in a visualization context, you will be interested in understanding trends and outliers. So trends, what the preponderance of the data is doing, and outliers is some sort of anomaly. Of course, the devil is in the detail. Figuring out exactly what counts as an outlier is the hard part. That's often why we visualize the data, because it's not there are many, many definitions of outliers, which means there's no single definition of outlier. Feature is a word I'm using generically to mean any sort of domain-specific particular thing. We can sort of abstract then into an idea of feature and think about some sort of system that would support that. Now, some tasks specifically have to do with attributes, and they depend on the number of attributes you're dealing with. If you're just dealing with a single attribute, the very, very common task is to understand the distribution of values within that attribute. In some cases, you just care about extremes like min and max, but often you're trying to understand something about the distribution. That is a task that pertains to one attribute. And in contrast, some tasks pertain to multiple attributes at once. Understanding if there's a dependency between one attribute and another, or is there a correlation between two attributes? Or is there some sort of similarity measure that lets you compare entire attributes to each other? These are things that intrinsically rely on having multiple, not just one, attributes in order to do those. Now, some kinds of targets are specific to specific data types. Like with network data, one target is that you need to understand the topological structure, the way that you can hop between nodes going only through the links. And that's a topological, not a geometric consideration. So like, for example, following a path through a network is an example of a topological task. And so that is specific to network data. Another one that is specific to data set type is understanding shape. With spatial data, with intrinsically spatial data, shape is a crucial question. So for example, if you have, you know, three-dimensional medical imaging and you're trying to understand, say, the shape of a tumor compared to the bone that it's right next to, understanding that shape is an intrinsic part of what you're trying to do. As we'll talk about more when we get to abstract tabular data, one tricky thing is that if you choose the spatial position of the visual encoding for a data set, as we often do with tabular rather than spatial data sets, in that case, shape is less interesting because shape is a choice by the designer. When shape is an intrinsic property of the data itself, as with spatial position data, that is when we really care about understanding shape. So these action target pairs I've just presented, this is a place to start. It's not a place to end. So it is a starting point for talking about visualization abstractly, but in many cases, you are going to need more precision than just this set of things I've mentioned. So if you're dealing with domain data and you're trying to think about how to abstract that, you know, a good place to start is, you know, try to translate domain jargon into something a bit more domain independent. But you will often need to go and come up with a lot of terms beyond just these ones I've talked about. And I will also mention that there is this interplay between the task and the data abstraction. The point of these abstractions is to talk in a domain-independent way, which means that in the task abstraction, you need to use the data abstraction as part of that language to specify the target. That's why we do the data abstraction. But I already said that the task abstraction could lead you to transform that data. So there is this sort of iteration where you go back and forth between proposals of doing this. It's very common that you will need multiple passes or you go back and forth between these abstractions before you're fully finished. I also want to point out that you don't necessarily just have one task. You often have this chained series of tasks where there's some dependency. And one way that's useful to think about this is sometimes you have an end goal in mind, the end, but sometimes you need to do something along the way towards that end, and it's the means to the end. So some tasks might be in service of some other task as more of a goal. And so it can help you analyze data sets in terms of task abstractions if you remember that there can be a series of change tasks. So the question is, you know, did you wake up in the morning thinking, I want to look up this thing? No, but maybe you're trying to do an analysis where lookup is one step towards that. So you can think about tasks as means in addition to tasks as ends. So we've now talked through this idea that we can think about tasks abstractly as these action target pairs. I've given you some initial places to start with actions as analyze, search, and query, and with different kinds of targets for those. But in many real-world contexts, you're going to want to go deeper and go more precise.